heart that hurts. I want to spend my life mending broken people. I want to spend my life mending broken people.
Hello and welcome to another 3ABN Today program. Thank you again for joining us as you do each and every day. And you know, again, we can't thank you enough for your prayers and your financial support of the ministry of 3ABN. Because if it weren't for you and the Lord Jesus Christ, 3ABN wouldn't be able to spread the gospel around the world. And it's a blessing to be able to join with you as team members. You know, you have the people here at 3ABN that work behind the scenes, maybe in front of the camera some, but also you at home are very, very important, especially for your prayers and again, your financial support. Thank you for standing with us, some of you for many, many years. Now, I love that song. You know, you just watched the open and it's talking about mending broken people. And today, would you say our testimony or the ministry, we're actually gonna be talking about a school, the Holbrook Indian School, is really talking about, really, you could say, mending broken people. And all of us, you know, God can use us in multiple ways. So all of us have a ministry. We're talking about this school in particular today, and boy, some amazing testimonies of how God has worked in people's lives, how God is using this school. So make sure you don't turn the television off or turn the radio off, or if you're watching online, turn your computer off. You want to stay tuned and see how God is working. But, you know, we're talking about how God can use all of us. It's easy sometimes to say, oh, that's them. I don't know what God's given me to do. But you know, God has a purpose for each one of us. So we want to encourage you to whatever talent God has given you, to use it for Him. And you can't go wrong with that. But anyway, I don't want to talk too much. So sweetie, tell us who we have here today.
We are excited about our special program today. We do have Holbrook Indian School with us. And as you mentioned, sweetheart, each one of us are broken in some way. But the Lord Jesus Christ came that He would bring deliverance to the captives, to set at liberty those who are bound, and to pour in the oil of His Holy Spirit to bring comfort, peace, and healing. And so, in a special way, this school ministers to those who are broken or alone and brings healing and hope. And we are so excited to have them here. We have some testimonies, testimonies right here on the set of what God is doing in their lives. So we want to introduce them to you at this time. Sitting right here on my right is Jovannah Poor Bear Adams. Did I get that name?
Perfect.
And we welcome you, and tell us, what is your role with Holbrook?
Well, right now I'm the Dean of Student Services and Programming, and what that means is I just develop different programming to encompass and connect bridges at our school. I developed a dorm curriculum through this school year because we get a wide range of students, first through 12th grade, and there's a lot of stuff we cover, hygiene and how to brush your teeth with some of them, all the way up into coping skills and study skills. So there's a wide range of things that our kids need in the dorm, and that's one of the things that I do there.
Amen. Now you have an, Jovannah has an amazing testimony, and we want to unpackage your testimony during the interview here. You went to Holbrook and how God used the school and other methods to bring healing to your life, and now you're giving back. So we're excited to hear your testimony. And sitting next to you is Adrienna Billy. And Adrienna, you're currently a student there, is that correct?
Yes.
And tell us what your role is, what your grade is, and you actually have a student office there too. So tell us about
Well, I am a Student Association Religious Vice President, and my role there is to help the students become more closer to God. Because lots of lots of kids from the reservation, they really didn't grow up knowing about God. And so they grew kind of like traditional. So most of them may not like it when like I go out or do an activity that has to do something with God, but I respect that, so I really don't push them.
Amen.
But then, so lots of people, like most of the students there at the school, they know a lot now. And so it's kind of like my job to like get them closer to God and to let them know that God is there with them.
Amen. Well, that's wonderful, and we want to hear your testimony, too. And sitting at the far end is Loren Fish, and you and your wife moved to Holbrook just a couple years ago. And what is your role there?
Yes, thanks for having us. Mm-hmm. I'm a clinical counselor there at Holbrook Indian School. And it's an honor to be able to work with the students and to have a counseling center right there on campus. It's much more convenient, provides Christian counseling for the students.
Amen.
It's a blessing, isn't it, to be able to work for the Lord, isn't it?
Amen.
And to see lives being changed, you know, building the relationship with God.
Yes.
Isn't that neat? It's so exciting.
Yeah.
And you were talking about, too, Adrienna, as far as, you know, building the relationship, right? You're talking to the other students, your fellow students that you're with.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just great. As far as a building a relationship with Jesus, you can't go wrong with that.
Amen. Well, we're excited about the program and to hear the testimonies and stories of what God's doing in the school, the Holbrook Indian School. But before we do that, we have music, sweetheart, and you have
we
a scripture
do.
As well, don't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, you know, that's right. Yes, we have Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6.
And this is one Loren especially liked.
Yeah, there's a, yes, yeah. Do you have that one, actually, Loren? You want to read that, actually?
I do.
Change it up here.
I do. Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ.
And why is that important? Why is that one of your favorite? I know there's many in the Bible.
As a clinical counselor there at Holbrook SDA Indian School, I don't always get to see the results of my work with the students. I don't always get to see the fruits of even the spiritual seeds that are planted. And so for me, it gives me confidence that God's in charge of these changes that are going on and not me.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is a promise that I hold dear to. I have it on the wall in my office.
So. You know, and that's great. I think one of the key words you mentioned there was promise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and God has a promise. He's committed that, he'll complete it and finish it. And amen. That's a great text. We do want to go to music, like we mentioned. Then we'll get into the full story here. And we have Natalie Nestruck here with us today. And she's going to be singing a beautiful song, Prayer for a Friend. Amen. Amen. What a powerful song. You know, I lift my friend up to you. You know, isn't that great? All of us can pray. We're talking about the ministry of, thank you for praying for the ministry of 3ABN. All of these other ministries like the Holbrook Indian Seventh-day Adventist School, I tell you, ministries around the world, and also our friends. It could be, this is the a powerful thing of prayer, is that you can be going down the street. Sometimes Jill and I will be doing this, and an ambulance will go by, just sirens blaring. We have no clue who's in the ambulance, what emergency they're going to. But the
and
power
then we always
prayer,
say, let's stop and pray right
you
now.
You can pray and say, Lord, driving. Be with that person, whatever the emergency situation is. So, wow, what a powerful song. Thank you, Natalie.
Amen. If you're just joining us, we have Holbrook Indian School with us. And we have Jovannah Poor Bear Adams and Adrienna Billy and Loren Fish. And we want to unpackage your story and hear more about the Holbrook Indian School. But before we go to that, we wanted to go to a special role. Terry Benedict was at the school sometime ago and produced this short film, short documentary. It features some of your story, Jovannah, and then some other statistics, and we want to use it as our springboard for discussion. So let's go to that role at this time.
Just tell it like it is.
Okay, so let me try and do that. When the Christian boarding school first came into existence here in America, the motto and the driving force behind it was to kill the Indian and save the man. And that is a part of the stigma that a lot of tribes, a lot of Native Americans, and especially traditional Native Americans, carry against schools like us. Our school is not about killing the Indian. It's not about killing what is native in the kids. It is about healing them. It is about claiming their identity, their culture, their faith, their themselves. I was molested by one of my stepdads for a year and a half, maybe 2 years before I even knew anything. Even before I was afraid that my mom was gonna be mad at me, that it was my fault for not saying anything or my fault for pretending I was sleeping every time. You know, I was raped by my older cousin, and I remember telling him that he was hurting me. And he said he was getting me ready to be an adult. And so what that told me was being an adult hurts. And it's something that you just have to deal with. It's something that just happens. It's gonna happen all through your life. You're going to hurt. People are going to hurt you. They're going to use your body for themselves for the rest of your life. And that was my reality. I I feel like people shouldn't have to go through this. I know that these kids live in this right now. I know that when I go into the dorm and I talk to those girls and I tell them about who I am and where I came from, I can see it on their faces that they're in it right now. And when we call CPS because somebody's stepdad is sexually abusing them and CPS does nothing about it, or the tribe does nothing about it, and they still have to go home to that, and they have to stay with their mom who blames them for their stepdad having to leave or having to go to jail, it makes me sick. They shouldn't have to go through this. And if they do, if they have to go through this, it shouldn't be normal. They shouldn't feel like this is just the way it is, and this is the way it's always going to be, and that's what you just have to accept.
I don't want to be stuck on the res, because once you're on the res, you stay on the res. And I want to start something new. The one thing my grandpa taught me is that God's there for you. You just keep looking forward, don't look backwards. That's why I came to Holbrook, and Holbrook's been my home. When I'm riding horses, it just feels amazing because it's silent, it's peaceful. The only thing you can hear is just the birds chirping and the breeze on the leaves. I feel more myself. I mean, I conquered my fears on riding horses and stuff. And I have no reason to be scared of a horse because they're just horses.
When I run, it feels like home to me. I just like the smell of the trees, and you know, I like the feeling of the dirt. My brothers, they drink and they smoke. I don't like that. So I try to get away from it as possible. I decided I wanted to come to Holbrook. And when I got there, I noticed it was different. I noticed the kids there were a lot more different. They weren't so mean or so irritating. The teachers too, they were really different. They didn't seem so mean, or they just seemed calm and nice. They really helped you with all your stuff, your education. I believe that this school provided more than just 100%. And I like that, and it's awesome.
I've seen kids come in here and trust no one. I've seen them come in here addicted to anything that you can be addicted to, anything they can get their hands on. Anything that numbs. I've seen them come in here homeless. We've had kids come in here and stay in the dorms because they're too afraid to go home. And I've seen them change from that. There are people who may want to see numbers. They want to see how many people were baptized that year. But there is more when a kid learns to trust somebody. Or when they're being abused at home, or someone's yelling and they can call me, or they can call the pastor, or they can call a teacher, and they can say, come pick me up, I'm scared. That's worth it. Because they have nobody before that. When I look back at my life, I love my experience here, and it's where I changed. And then I changed more in college. And then I changed more when I came back to school here. And I can tell you, I am still living my dream. I'm living it.
Thank you so much, Terry Benedict, for putting that together. I understand he volunteered his time, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
To put this together, and he did an incredible job.
Absolutely, he did. Heavy duty statistics.
It is.
Yeah, and what amazing testimony.
And as I sat and watched that, I had the opportunity to see it right before the program here. And I just sat and cried a minute.
Mm-hmm.
It's heavy. Heavy topic, difficult things, Jovannah, that you've had to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, I know you said it was normal in your home growing up, but is that normal, would you say, across the board for many growing up?
One of the things that as you cross reservations all across the United States, and actually there's more than 500 registered Native American tribes in the United States, but overwhelmingly as you learn about them, there's high alcohol, high diabetes, high abuse rates in across the board. There are people who manage and they work very hard to create healthy environments for their families, but it's few and far between. And there are reservations as a whole that are doing very, very well. But again, that's few and far between across the 500 plus that there are.
Would you say this is generational? Like, this is how I was raised, and then you pass it down to your kids? Like that cycle of dysfunction, that cycle of abuse, would you say that continues generationally?
Definitely.
Okay.
One of the places that it start again, as the United States was being colonized, it was a breaking down of a people. First by completely trying to eliminate them, period, and then breaking them down, like the video had said, to kill the Indian and save the man, to break down what's native in them, their identity as native people, to break that down. And that is what started this cycle of abuse, broken people, raising broken people, and it continuing down the line. And that's what we're dealing with today, is a long history of abuse and brokenness.
Yes. So how did you, I just want to know some of your story, how did you first hear about Holbrook? And first of all, tell us what tribe you're from.
I'm an Oglala Lakota Sioux. I'm from the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in South Dakota. And if you're not familiar with that, it is the tribe of Crazy Horse.
Okay, well, we know about him, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
Big, amazing monument of Crazy Horse.
Yeah.
Mount Rushmore.
Yeah, right next to it. In on our reservation specifically, it's much smaller. Again, it's one of the larger ones, but the Navajo reservation is the largest in the United States, and that's where our school is just off of.
Mm-hmm.
But on our reservation, I grew up on and off of it. It's like the properties around it are like farmers and ranchers.
Mm-hmm.
And I had experience, like the video said, being sexually abused, being raped. My mom had been married 4 times and divorced 4 times by the time that I was 16 years old.
Wow.
And
Did you tell anyone? Did you try to reach out to your mom and say, hey, this is what's going on to me? Or were you too ashamed to say anything? Or?
I was very scared. One of the things is I knew that it was supposed to be a secret. Mm-hmm. I was afraid of my stepdad. I was mm-hmm. afraid that if I did tell somebody that they would blame it on me. And the truth is, when I told my mom, she stood by me.
Oh,
she did. She divorced him. We went to court. The court didn't necessarily stand by us. We got a restraining order, and that's the extent of that. But a lot of our students and a lot of people, they either don't report it, or when they do, or they tell their parents, they might get it blamed on them. Mm-hmm. We've had students who have come forward, and the parents say, I don't understand. This happened to me and I'm fine. I don't know why she's making such a big deal about this.
Wow.
Mm. And so
it becomes normal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's painfully so, a painful secret. And so that's something that our school, that we try to work on. This is not pain that you should have to carry. Mm-hmm. And this isn't something that you should have to hide within yourself. It's something you can heal from, and you should work for that.
Mm. So I know we're in the middle of your story, but it just made me think, Loren, you work specifically with counseling. So what are some of the things that you, and I think you have a female counselor there too, so what are some of the things that you all work with the students who come in? Because they would come in with this background of neglect or abuse or trauma. Obviously not all of them, but some of them come in with that.
I would say about 75% have PTSD symptoms of some kind, and that's from various forms of abuse. We do have a female counselor. She's actually in her last semester of getting her master's in counseling.
Wow.
And so she's a case manager right now, Giselle Ortiz. But she does a really awesome job, especially with the girls. She does things, she works with them in ways that I can't.
Of course.
She has girls' groups with the different age levels, elementary, middle school, and high school. In fact, Adrienna is a member of her high school girls group. So,
oh, that's
wow.
great.
And she works with them on things like trust, and especially in finding their worth in Christ. Mm. Because that's a lot of them come, when you have abuse of any kind, you get negative beliefs about yourself mm-hmm. that are produced in those negative events. And so if my negative belief about myself is I'm not good enough, or I'm not worthy, or I'm not lovable, then you can say God loves you, but if you don't believe that you're lovable, then you're not going to buy it. So a lot of times it's helping them see themselves differently so that they can allow that perception that God does care for you and loves you.
Yeah. Mm. Well, yeah, no, that's powerful. It really is. And I'm thinking then, because it's just amazing to me how, you know, God, you know, it's just horrible, you know, background, you know, far as, you know, all the pain and abuse in your life, to how God is using you now at Holbrook to work as a vessel that God can pour through to others to help them in their terrible situations that they're in. So I'm just curious as to how did you go, I know you went to school, but how did you end up going to Holbrook School, Indian School?
Something that... on our reservation, something that I had decided for myself in being with my mom is that I would not be stuck there.
Mm.
I would not continue there, and I wouldn't drink, because something that after my mom decided that she wasn't going to drink anymore, we started going to AA meetings and sobriety events, and we went with her. I went with mm-hmm. her to those things, and so it was ingrained in me that this is not the way that it should be. This is not something that should continue. After my mom had taken my stepdad to court and divorced him, and it crashed on her and it crashed on us, she left us. And she left us with my grandma, and she lived 2 hours away from us.
Mm. So your mom was broken because of that?
And yeah,
she,
well,
okay.
She's definitely experienced her own trauma, severe trauma, and I believe that this triggered in her that, and so she left. And we lived on the reservation on treaty land with my grandma, and it was there on the reservation that I experienced hunger like I had never in my life, and never since then. Mm. There were times that my grandma would get her meals on wheels lunch thing, and we would all crowd around her, and she would open it up and choose the one thing that she was going to eat out of it.
Wow.
And then pass it to the rest of us, and we'd be standing around her, and we'd get to choose our one thing out of her meal. There was another time I sat out on the lawn and I started eating a weed that was growing in the lawn because I was hungry.
So hungry.
And I started eating. Final one. There was another time my stomach was so tight and there was such a pain in my stomach. And I was so young that I was so smart. I knew that if I started swallowing the air and I just expanded my stomach, it would stop hurting. And so I just started taking big gulps to make the pain stop in my stomach.
I'm sorry for what you experienced. That's a lot of pain.
I sincerely believe that this whole process, the life that I grew up in, the way that I grew up, prepared me for the work that I'm in right now.
Yes.
And it's one of the reasons that I work so hard at what I'm doing, the reason we try and my family's where we are. It's because God was preparing me for this work, to work with Native people.
Yes.
When I was in the eighth grade, I had started drinking. I started getting high and going out. And it wasn't until my little sister had told me that she hated me that I realized I had become what I had feared.
Yeah.
And
what you had seen growing up.
Yeah.
You're turning into that.
Yes, I was just continuing that process. And a friend of mine, her uncle, had actually gone to Holbrook Indian School. And he was Seventh-day Adventist, which I had not even heard about. I didn't know that he was even Christian, because there's not very many Christians on the reservation. Adriana is very fortunate to come from a Christian family. Her mom has taken them to church and taken them and taught her family about God. But that's not very common on the reservation.
What would be the religion of most of the Indians on the reservation?
Most of our students, well, a lot of them come from traditional beliefs, maybe not practicing very much, but they come from a traditional understanding. And a lot of people don't think, the nicest way to say it, very fondly of Christians or Christianity.
Okay.
When I had actually become Seventh-day Adventist and I was baptized, I had told my mother that I could no longer do ceremonies. I couldn't participate in the ceremonies. And what she had told me was that I had turned my back on my family and on my people. Oof. And on her.
Wow.
And she had told me that she loved me so much, past tense, that she had loved me so much, and that everything that I was to her, everything I was going to do for my people and my family, that my younger sister would take that.
Wow.
That was her place now.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Boy.
That's difficult. I mean, did your mom ever change, or is it still that way to this day?
My mom is actually she's grown so much then, and we have grown together. We didn't talk about it for probably 2 years.
Wow.
Then I would go home and be made fun of, and sometimes we still do. We still do. But when I graduated high school, in our culture, you get a new traditional outfit. And so she had made me a new traditional outfit, new beadwork, everything. And so when I graduated from Holbrook, I wore a new outfit, and she showed me the moccasins, and on the back of the leggings was a cross beaded into it.
Aww.
And she didn't never said anything about it, but what it was a huge identity thing for me. It was my traditional moccasins, my beadwork with a Christian symbol, a symbol of Christianity in there. And so it ties in who I am.
Yes.
I am Native American and I am Christian.
Mm. Amen.
Amen.
I love that. So you went at eighth grade.
Ninth grade.
Yes. You went to Holbrook, and then you were there all 4 years.
Yes.
And where in that process, what year were you baptized? Was it during that or was it after?
I was baptized when I was 16 years old, so I was a sophomore in school. And I actually went to the school not wanting to be Christian. My mom had said before I left that she didn't want me to go, but that if I was going to go, then if it's what you have to do, then go. But know this. When that school, it's a Christian school, and they will lie to you.
Ooh.
They will tell you anything that they have to get you to believe the way that they do. And so when I went to the school, I fought it. And I tried hard in everything that I could, but I also tried hard not to be Christian. And I had A's that first quarter in all of my classes, except for Bible. Bible. And I was determined I was going to have perfect grades, so I needed to take a Bible study so that I could learn how to pretend to be Christian and get an A in this class too. And when that Bible study was finished, I wanted more. And so I went to another Bible study with just me and a friend of mine, with some of the staff, a husband and a wife. And after that Bible study, I had to be a part of this. Wow. I had to be a part of the church.
Wow.
And I wanted more of Christ in my life.
Amen. Oh, so go ahead.
I was just thinking, so Lauren, so then just describe what Holbrook is, because, you know, it's actually where you would learn reading, writing, and arithmetic, so they say. It's not just as like a center for, I mean, there's healing there, obviously, you know, all the emotional and all that healing. But this is actually an academic school, plus you add in all this, I guess the counseling would be a good way of describing it.
We have a holistic approach there at Holbrook SDA Indian School. The New You program, nutrition, exercise, and wellness, that really kind of undergirds a lot of what we do there. We have a horse program, as you saw in the video, and that can be very healing for students. And we have a garden program, garden to plate, where the students can actually work in the garden, get their hands dirty, and then they get to eat the product in the cafeteria afterwards.
Well, so that's fun.
It's very, very,
eat it.
Yeah, very rewarding for them. And the counseling department is just a small part of that holistic approach, where we try to help them to learn to trust not only the staff there, but also God as well.
You know, I would think trust would be a big deal, because really when you think about home, you know, we think of home as the place where you have the highest trust for your family. And here that's been, I mean, totally just ripped out from under you. And so how do you deal with that as far as the whole trust thing? Because here they are coming to a school, they probably don't know the staff, they're trying to learn some of the students maybe. How do you deal with that?
It's very interesting. Actually, my wife tells a story that we'd been there a few months and a student came up to her and said, so when are you guys leaving? And so
what a question.
Yeah.
So when are you leaving?
Yeah. And there was a staff that just recently came too, and they were asked the same thing. When are you leaving? So there's a level of trust that needs to be built. It was very fortunate for me as a counselor that we had the case manager, Ms. Ortiz, already there, because she was able to establish that trust and then sort of hand some of the students to me and say, he can help you. And so that was a huge help. But it takes time. Literally, it takes time. And so we have to be very patient. And sometimes the students come there and then their parents take them away. And then sometimes they come back. But one of the things I like is that we work with the students. Just because they mess up, we're not like, okay, you're out of here.
That's good.
We really take the time to work with them individually. We have individual plans for each student that gets in trouble. We say, this is the best way for you to get to where you want to be. Because a lot of times, I mean, even when I was in a Adventist Academy, when I was in high school, you know, we'd send the kids that were bad apples, we'd send them away.
Yes.
And to me, even as a sophomore in high school, I said, when I grow up, I want to be a counselor and I want to live right near an Adventist Academy and I want to work with those kids to help them.
Wow.
And so it's really awesome that God has kind of fulfilled the desires of my heart to be in this role where I'm at now, and I know that I'm exactly where God wants me to be right now.
God put that in your heart. I mean, that's incredible. And then God fulfilled the desire of your heart, and that's beautiful.
Yeah. He's awesome.
You were going to say something, Jovannah?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
No.
Family is so huge. It's such a huge part of Native American culture and a lot of cultures. So tight and so much love, like, and responsibility to each other. And so when the trust is broken and when the hurt and the pain comes from family, it's so severely internalized. Yeah. And like what you're talking about, a break of trust, it's like a break of human, like of self. And so one of the biggest ways that our students are able to learn to trust us is we try to become family to them.
Oh, that's great.
And it's a small community. I mean, our student body is about 70 students on our campus, and then maybe 15 to 20 in our Chinle school. That's actually on the reservation. But we have faculty families. So in my family, I have about 5 students that come into my home, and we spend time with them, and we pray together, and we eat together, and we spend the Sabbath together.
So each staff is assigned, as you could say, certain students to become a family with.
Yeah, and I love that. And that's a part of what builds trust in them. As we become closer to them and we allow them to become closer to us, our ministry means more. We show them the kind of love and the kind of connections that you can have with God.
Yes. So Adrienna, you came from a different background than Jovannah, is that correct? You had food growing up, and you came from a stable home, or what was your home like growing up?
My home was kind of like comfortable and all that. And I would come home after school, like wanting to be home, but wanting to play outside with my friends. And so my parents were really nice too. And like they would provide me for the things that I need and all that. And so, yeah.
So Holbrook is a boarding school, correct? But you also have day students that come, or is it only boarding?
It's actually only boarding.
Only boarding. Yeah. So yeah, you're boarding there then? Mm-hmm. You're staying there?
How long have you been at the school?
I've been there for like about 3 years, but this is my 4th year, so.
Okay. So you came in elementary school then, if you're...
No, I came as a 7th grader in junior high.
Junior high. Okay, perfect. So what would a day in the life of a student be like? If you were to walk us through what a normal day looks like, what would that be like?
Like what time do you get up and get ready for school?
I think I'll kind of be pretty normal again at the same time, because I do that every time a lot, and I think like there's really nothing different about it, because that's what I've been doing throughout like most of my whole life.
So really, then you probably have do you have a chapel time or devotional time as a group, as a whole student?
Or do you meet with your individual families where you're for that, or how does that?
No, what we do is like we have worship in a chapel in our own dorm, so all the girls in the whole girls' dorm would all go to chapel together, and then all the boys in the boys' chapel all together.
That's great. And then do you do, is it a work-study program, Lauren, or is it just...
Because you're talking about
do
like
you
the
do
garden
some,
and...
The garden is and the horsemanship are classes that the students take, so it's more considered classes. We do have some students working in the cafeteria and in the administration building and stuff like that, but...
Is that you? I said, yep.
Like, Adrienna says, that's me.
Well, just so you know, when I was going to school, I worked in the cafeteria too, I enjoyed that.
Yeah. I'm sorry, go ahead. You were
describing the work study. And
it's more classes. Okay. We also have welding, which is a very important.
It's a good trade, isn't
class,
it?
Class, yeah, yeah. Some of the students go on to trade school and get their welding degree. So.
Oh, that's great, yes.
So how is Holbrook then supported? Then is it supported by donation strictly or the tuition? How do you guys fund, are funded?
About 20% of our budget comes from the Pacific Union Conference. We are
Excellent.
Managed under the Pacific Union. But 80% of it comes from donations and from support to the school. We have a tuition of $87 for each of our students.
Per month.
Which is $87 per month.
Extremely low, yeah.
Yeah,
room and board?
It includes everything.
Everything, so
room and
all your
board
academics, wow.
Yeah, it includes everything. And in all actuality, there are lots of our students and probably most of them do not pay that.
Okay.
Because if you imagine a home without running water, without electricity, and sometimes even like a dirt floor, $87 a month is huge. And so many of our students don't pay that because they can't, because that is food money, or this is the gas money we use to get them to school. And so it's more a matter of, if you can, invest in your school. be a part of this. Mm-hmm. The kids apply for scholarships and stuff, so it's an introduction to continuing and valuing your education.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah.
So then I know that we're going to the address break soon, but I'm wondering then, as far as sponsors, are the people that sponsor then students, do you do that, or more is it just like a worthy student where people can actually just donate? So we're going to be talking about that here shortly, where you can, if you feel a burden that, wow, you can't maybe be part of a ministry, even in your local area, but you say, man, I just feel impressed with the Holy Spirit to support this. You accept donations from those that are viewing on 3ABN, correct, mm-hmm. to support these students, to continue to support this wonderful school.
Yes, of course. There's a wide variety. If you go to our website, you can actually donate right on the website
Go
on there. Yeah, really easy. And that's new, too. That's, again, something that Terry Benedict has helped us start with our school and a part of his ministry for our school. But we do have sponsoring kids where you can decide. We have a worthy student fund where you can put towards it for students that can't pay the $87.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that's where a lot of the tuition goes to the kids for that. Mm-hmm. But then there's sponsoring students through our development director. She has students that she knows are very high need. Mm. This year we had a 5-year-old come into our dorm.
Oh wow.
As in the first grade. And 5-year-olds are typically in the kindergarten.
Oh yeah.
She's with her grandparents and she needed help. Her brother was at the school. And I interviewed with her before we accepted her into the first grade, and I had her sing the ABCs with me and see how high she could count. And then I asked her where she sleeps. Mm-hmm. And that was intentional because of the dorm, mm-hmm. Especially when little kids, it's very hard for them to be in the dorm.
Mm-hmm.
And she had said, well, I sleep on the floor with my grandma.
Hmm.
And
on the floor.
Yeah, on the floor with her grandma. And so we knew during the interview that we had to take her. Not that she needed to come. She sees her grandma all the time. So, but that she needed help.
And the environment that she would be in would be much
better. Yes, and so she has a sponsor.
Oh. Wow.
And so there is someone who sends her some clothes every now and then, and some letters, and
that's precious.
You know, just that. Almost like taking her as mm-hmm. a part of themselves. Mm-hmm. And so through our development director, she helps sponsor kids mm-hmm. as well. But overall, the overwhelming need is to support the programs that these kids are a part of, to send money for the counseling or for the horsemanship program or for the general fund, period.
Yeah, operation. Well,
yes.
Yeah. Loren.
Please don't be discouraged if you can't financially support the school, because we need prayer warriors too. And I know that 3ABN has awesome prayer warriors.
That's
but
right.
But we literally can see the great controversy play out there almost every day at school. Mm. So we really need to be backed up with some prayer warriors.
Yeah. Amen. Do you have prayer warriors there who are part of the staff? Do you guys gather and do that, or?
Yeah. We would like to do it more regular, but we meet every day as a staff, and we have specific prayers. And then we have some people that are really good at it that we can say, hey, could you pray especially for this?
Mm-hmm. You know, I liked what you said earlier, and I know we just are running out of time. It's amazing how fast this hour has gone. But you mentioned something about a program called New You, and I know you touched on it just briefly, mm-hmm. but again, describe that real quick, what that is, because I like that. You know, we're used to, is it New Start?
Mm-hmm.
We go through nutrition mm-hmm. and all that, but I like mm-hmm. the New You.
New You. Yeah, it's something that we use as a wraparound for all of the extracurricular holistic approach to helping the students become more well-rounded.
Excellent.
A lot of times, people think that the first effort should be, well, we need to make Christians out of them first. Mm-hmm. I say the first effort should be to help them restore their minds to health. And so that would be with exercise and nutrition. That would be getting outside, working in the garden,
Breathing the fresh air.
Running is a big part of the Navajo tradition. And so we like to allow the students to do a lot of running for the PE program. And then you have the counseling program. You have Jovannah working with the deans to incorporate some life skills into the dorm program. And so it's really a team approach. My wife likes to tell the staff as the development director, she says, everyone here is a development director. and so as a counselor, I like to tell the staff, you all are counselors. We all need to be working on this together. It's a team effort.
Amen. Amen. That's wonderful. Well, we're going to go to your contact in just a moment. But Jovannah, we did not even finish your story. So you left Holbrook. You went, after you graduated, you went to Union College.
Yes.
And you got your degree in?
English education. I'm a certified English teacher.
Mm-hmm. And you met your husband there at Union?
Yes, I did. I love theater, and so I was a part of Union College's drama. I was a part of the drama department, and my husband built sets.
Oh, yeah.
So we met on the set of Union Colleges.
And now you have a precious little girl.
I have three precious.
Oh, three? Yes. I didn't know that. I just met the one. So.
I'm starting my own tribe. I've got two boys and one girl, and my son is seven, and he actually goes to our school. He's in the second grade.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's just been an incredible journey, mm-hmm. hearing each one of your testimonies and hearing about what God is doing in mm-hmm. and through the ministry of Holbrook Indian School. So we want to encourage you. Maybe you know a young person who would be interested in attending. Maybe you want to sponsor and help out financially.
Right.
Here is how you can get in touch with Holbrook Indian School.
If you would like to learn more about Holbrook Indian School, you can do so by writing to Post Office Box 910, Holbrook, Arizona 86025. That's Post Office Box 910, Holbrook, Arizona 86025. You can call them at 928-524-6845, extension 109. That's 928-524-6845, extension 109. You can also find them online at holbrookindianschool.org. That's holbrookindianschool.org.
Amen. We hope that you take advantage of contacting Holbrook Indian mm-hmm. School, of praying for them, or financially supporting them. And if you did not have time to write down that address, you can always call us at 3ABN, and we'll be happy to put you in touch with Holbrook School. Mm-hmm. And we just want to thank each one of you for coming here.
Thank you.
And
yes.
want to give you a moment to share a closing thought with our family at home. So, Loren.
One of the things I found out when I first got to Holbrook SDA Indian School is that the students view family much differently than Western culture does. So I would ask them, so you have any family here, any brothers or sisters? And they said, yeah, I have a brother and a sister. And I find out later, no, that was their cousin. And so family is viewed much broader, and that's because they see family just beyond the nuclear family. They see clans, and they have a way of introducing themselves that describes their clans of their parents and their grandparents. And I wanted Adrienna to share that with
oh,
us.
Oh, wow. Yeah, let's hear. Let's hear what that sounds like.
Yat is Adrienna Billy in a share. Total Nishlin, Naz as a touch in a Pashishin, Turich in a Dashache, Husklish in a Dashanella.
Wow. That's incredible. So the root, you're saying the root system, you would say, with the family is much deeper.
Ancestry
mm-hmm. you could say. Mm-hmm. So you are, and what language was that? You're Navajo, right?
Mm-hmm. And that's Navajo.
Navajo, wow, it's incredible.
It's beautiful.
Amen.
Oh, it really is.
And that just goes as a testimony of how close family is and how much your family is a part of your identity.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is what the students are. They identify by this chain of family. Much like in the Bible, when they introduce someone, they give
genealogy.
The lineage.
The genealogy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that is something that the Navajo people do, is mm-hmm. they give you a lineup of, this is who I am. Mm-hmm. This is the people I've come from.
Yes, yes. Wow. Now, Jovannah, what if someone's watching maybe today, and I didn't tell you this ahead of time, but maybe someone comes from a background of abuse, someone's hurting and broken inside, what would you tell them?
I would tell them that Christ provides healing. And when I first came to Holbrook Indian School, I rejected Christ. I rejected Christianity because of what I thought that it stood for. Mm. And as I learned more and as I clung to Christ more, I couldn't let go because of who I learned and knew that He was in reality.
Amen.
And God provides healing.
Mm-hmm.
And He doesn't, you can't keep secrets from God. And so He can heal even the the broken pieces that you try to hide.
Mm-hmm. Amen. What a testimony of the healing that God has done in your life. Your testimony has blessed and inspired me. And thank you, Jovannah, for coming and for sharing and for giving back. As God has worked to heal you, you're working to heal other people, or God through you is working to heal other people. Adrienna, thank you for coming and sharing some of your journey as a student there at Holbrook. And we pray for God's blessings over you. And Loren, thank you for you and your wife and for your ministry at the school, working to bring that help and hope and healing.
Praise God. Covet your prayers.
Amen. Amen. And we thank you at home for joining us as part of the 3ABN family. We want to encourage you to pray for each one of these people on the set and for Holbrook Indian School for God's continued blessing and healing and anointing. Our time is all gone. Know that we love you and we pray for you as well. God bless you.
Amen.